السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
السلام وبركاته.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، نتابع القراءة في كتاب الأدب المفرد للإمام البخاري محمد بن إسماعيل رحمه الله. باب كن لليتيم كالأب الرحيم. حدثنا عمرو بن عباس، حدثنا عبد الرحمن، حدثنا سفيان عن أبي إسحاق قال سمعت عبد الرحمن بن أبزة قال قال داود عليه السلام كن لليتيم كالأب الرحيم. ذكرنا هذا الحديث في المرة الماضية، وذكرنا أن هذا ليس له حكم الحديث، إنما يغلب عليه أن يكون من الإسرائيليات التي لا تصدق ولا تكذب لأنها لم تخالف نصا، فيقول كن لليتيم كالأب الرحيم، واعلم أنك كما تزرع كذلك تحصد، ما أقبح الفقر بعد الغنى وأكبر من ذلك وأقبح من ذلك الضلالة بعد الهدى، وإذا وعدت صاحبك فأنجز له ما وعدته، فإن لا تفعل توث بينك وبينه عداوة، وتعوذ بالله من صاحب إن ذكرت لم يعنك وإن نسيت لم يذكرك. So we mentioned this narration last time, and it's a narration of one of the early scholars, I think he's one of the tabi'een, when he mentioned a story saying of Dawood alayhi salam. He doesn't say that Rasulullah salam said it, so it's probably one of the Isra'iliyat, one of the narrations they heard it from the Jews in Medina, where they read from the Old Testament, saying that Dawood alayhi salam, he gave advice that you should be to the orphan like a merciful father, and the way that you would sow, the way that you harvest, that is whatever you do, you're going to see the results of it. People hate to be poor after they've been rich, but worse than that, people will go astray after they've been guided. If you promise your friend something, fulfill your promise, otherwise you're going to bring him enmity, he will hate you. And ask Allah to give you refuge, protect you from somebody. When you remember to do something, he would not help you. And if you forget, he would not remind you. That is about doing the right thing. So here the part that relates to the etiquettes about being good to the orphan, as if you are good, as the father is good to his children. And this, as I said, this is not a hadith, it's a saying, but it confirms that the teachings of all the prophets are the same. There is no difference. If you get the early books, whether they were Nuh or Ibrahim or Ishaq, Yaqub, his children, and so on, all of them are going to seem about the same. It's Islam, full submission to Allah, doing the right thing. And Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم has said, إنما بعثت لأتمم مكارم الأخلاق. That he was sent, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, to complete the good characters. So people already know what is right, what is wrong. But when wrong prevails, it becomes the norm. And so people start considering cheating and lying, being smart. And here, bringing everything back to the norm. No. Being good, the responsibility, first of all, between you and Allah. The society's norm could be right, could be wrong. What decides right and wrong is what Allah decides right and wrong. حدثنا موسى حدثنا حمزة بن نجيح أبو عمار قال سمعت الحسن. إذا ذكر الحسن ولم يسمى من الحسن يقصد به الحسن البصري إمام التابعين في البصرة. قال سمعت الحسن يقول لقد عهدت المسلمين وإن الرجل لا يصبح فيقول يا أهلاه يا أهلاه يتيمكم يتيمكم يا أهلاه يا أهلاه مسكينكم مسكينكم يا أهلاه يا أهلاه جاركم جاركم وأسرع بجنائزكم وأنتم كل يوم تبذلون. وسمعته يقول: وإذا شئت رأيته فاسقا يتعمق بثلاثين ألفا إلى النار، ما له؟ قاتله الله، باع خلاقه من الله بثمن عنز. وإن شئت رأيته مضيعا مرتدا في سبيل الشاه في سبيل الشيطان، لا واعظ له من نفسه ولا من الناس. أي أن هنا الحسن البصري يذكر كيف كانوا المسلمين في عهد الصحابة، ثم تأخروا في عهد التابعين، بدأ ينتشر عندهم سوء الأخلاق. This is narration from Al-Hasan al-Basri. Al-Hasan al-Basri is considered one of the top scholars of التابعين, the students of the Sahaba. And he, in his time, so you're talking about a couple generations after Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So you're talking about 50 years, 60 years after the Hijrah. And he's saying things have changed a lot. I used to see when a person would go around and say, oh, take care of the orphans, take care of the needy, of the poor, and so on. When there's the janazah, everybody would rush, take that janazah, bury it, and so on. So people were all together in doing the right thing. And now I'm seeing things are getting worse. I would see that somebody that only wants dunya, he will have 30,000 dinar. That's a big wealth. Imagine somebody nowadays have 30,000 piece of gold. That's a lot of money. I think now golden dollar is what, $5,000, $6,000, something like this. So you have 30,000 with that. That's a big wealth. So if somebody had that big wealth, and still, if he got something as cheap as buying a goat, he will sell his religion to get that money. So does that mean people started caring less about deen and caring more about dunya? And you see people are turning away from religion, and nobody is advising them, not from himself, not from anybody else. So here he's mentioning all of this together, that it all comes as a package. If somebody is not taking care of his religion, he's not going to take care of the orphan, he's not going to take care of the needy. كلا بل لا تكرمون اليتيم ولا تحاضون على طعام المسكين وتأكلون التراث أكلا لما. مثل القرآن always describing the kuffar. Not only they disbelieve Allah, it shows in their character. They don't care, they don't take care of the poor and the orphans. باب أدب اليتيم. حدثنا مسلم حدثنا شعبة عن شميسة العتكية قالت: ذكر أدب اليتيم عند عائشة فقالت: إني لأضرب اليتيم حتى ينبسط، حتى ينصلح. أي أن الإنسان يؤدب اليتيم كما يؤدب أولاده، ليس فقط يكرمه ويتركه حتى يفسد، فيكرمه عند الإكرام ويؤدبه في موضع التأديب. So here, this narration about how one would take care of the orphan. It's not always being nice and smiling, give him whatever you want. You don't spoil them. You will discipline them the same way you discipline your children. Aisha, she would say, I would discipline an orphan until he straightened up. There was narration before that. You straighten him the same way you would discipline, the same way you discipline your own child. So just because a person is an orphan doesn't mean they get a free ride. You raise them the same way you raise your children. باب فضل من مات له الولد. حدثنا إسماعيل قال حدثني مالك عن ابن شهاب عن ابن المسيب عن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال: لا يموت لأحد من المسلمين ثلاثة من الولد فتمسه النار إلا تحلة القسم. ما يقصد فيها تحلة القسم؟ وإن منكم إلا واردها. إنه لا يأتيه شيء من النار إلا أن يرد من النار فوقها فلا تحرقه. أي من مات له ولد فصبر على ذلك كان له نجاة من النار. So in this narration, Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, anybody that have three children that die, and he persevere, and he would account that with Allah, if he does that, the fire will not touch him except to fulfill the promise I've said that each one of us will see hellfire. Each one of us. So this is Ibur al-Sirat. When people are crossing the Sirat, it is built on hellfire. So all of us will see it. But the lucky ones will just see it and go. So it's just fulfilling the promise. وَإِن مِنْكُمْ إِلَّا وَارِدُهَا كَانَ عَلَى رَبِّكَ حَتْمًا مَقْضِيًّا. So everybody will see it, will approach it, but then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will save the believers, the good doers, and the non-believers, the sinners, will fall into it. So having three children, losing them, and having perseverance is a way to protect the person. That means this person has good character. He have faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's done his obligations. And then that perseverance is an act of piety that will wipe out a lot of his sins. That will end up his scale of good deeds will outweigh the scales of the bad deeds and will go to Jannah. وفي حديث عياش حدثنا عبد الأعلى حدثنا محمد بن إسحاق قال حدثني محمد بن إبراهيم بن الحارث عن محمود بن لبيد عن جابر بن عبد الله رضي الله عنهما قال سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول من مات له ثلاثة من الولد فاحتسبهم دخل الجنة قلنا يا رسول الله واثنان قال واثنان قلت وجابر والله أرى لو قلتم واحد قال لقال قال وإني وأظنه والله. So in this narration, Jabir ibn Abdullah, Jabir ibn Abdullah is a well-known Sahabi. He's the one that his father died in the battle of Uhud, and he left him with a lot of sisters. He's the only one taking care of them. So when he wanted to get married, Jabir chose an older woman rather than a younger woman. At that time, people thought he would choose a young woman. He said, I'm going to choose them a wife for me that's going to be like a mother to them. I don't want to choose a wife for them that will be like them. She would not be able to discipline them. And he was very close to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He learned a lot of things. The hadith of Hajj of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the majority of it was narrated by Jabir ibn Abdullah. So here in this hadith, he said, I'll hear Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, anybody that loses three children, and he persevere, he will go to Jannah. So somebody asked, how about two? He said, two also. And then Jabir said, if somebody asked him one, I'm very sure he would say even one. It's not the number of children that counts. It's the act of perseverance, knowing that Allah gives and Allah takes. And everybody will die eventually. Some will die younger, some will die older. It's the acts that you do in your life. And as a parent, the hardest test is to lose children. Somebody persevere, he will go to Jannah. So inshallah, we'll stop from the book of Adab here. And we'll read from Al-Fiqh al-Salah.
So in the first hadith, we mentioned that we got some of this information from the Isra'iliyat.
Yeah.
So why do the Muslim scholars depend on the Isra'iliyat? Is it to just compare our knowledge to their scholars' knowledge, or do we derive some derivations and conclusions from the Isra'iliyat to help interpret our aqidah?
So there are two main reasons to narrate Isra'iliyat. One of it, to confirm that the teachings of this religion is not a new innovation. That the teaching of Rasulullah sallam is the same teaching of Isa, of Musa, of Dawud, and everybody else. So, and that's what you're gonna see when you talk to people of faith, from different types of faith. When you start talking about good characters, being a good person, a lot of them share and agree with you. Being dutiful to your parents, taking care of the orphans, of the needy, being truthful, being honest, and so on. Everybody tell you, yeah, this is good character, because they come from the same source. The other one is explaining some of the historic events that mentioned in the Quran briefly, and might have more explanation Old Testament without necessarily knowing for sure that it is truthful. It's like we know in the children of Yaqub are 12. We only know the name of Yusuf, but we don't know the name of the rest of them. In the Old Testament, they mention the name of all of them. His younger brother is named Benjamin. So we know that. So we can say it because it doesn't contradict anything that we know. So you can take from it. But there are certain events and historic things that are mentioned. You take it with a grain of salt. If it conflicts with any non-religious event or with a scientific event, then we say it might be one of the things that they've altered. So that's the thing. So لا تصدقوهم ولا تكذبوهم. So you don't seek that knowledge, but if it comes and confirms or explains something, then there's nothing wrong with it. But you wouldn't take it. Like in the Old Testament, when they talk about the creation of Earth, that Earth was 3,000 years old. There's nothing in our religion, in Quran or Sunnah, telling us that Earth is 3,000 years old. And we know that this statement conflicts with scientific facts talking about billions of years. And we know in Quran tells you, وَإِنَّ يَوْمًا عِنْدَ رَبِّكَ كَأَلْفِ سَنَةٍ مَّا تَعَدُّونَ وَفِي يَوْمٍ كَانَ مِقْدَارُهُ خَمْسِينَ أَلْفَ سَنَةٍ. That the days of Allah are different from our counting. Allah mentioned one day as 1,000, one day as 50,000. Could be other days longer. When talking about the creation of heavens and earth, 6 days. Not our 6 days, 6 days for Allah. And Allah decided 6 days, that's His choosing. And seventh day, He didn't feel tired to rest as they claim. The Sabbath, that they claim after Allah got tired in 6 days building heavens and earth, He needed to rest. Allah doesn't need rest. وَمَا مَسَّنَا مِنْ لُغُوبٍ. That Allah did not get tired from creating it. Allah could have created in one incident. كُن بِيَنْ it is. But Allah has sunan, He have developed laws for this creation, how things progress. From what we know from nowadays science, you have the Big Bang, then you had things expanding, you have gases, then became stars, became galaxies, some of them cool off, become this planet. It took some time until it cooled off, you got the water, you get the plants, you get the animals. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Adam from heavens. So we don't believe in humans evolving from another creature. We know that Allah created it. Other creatures within the species, they evolve. This is natural. We see big horses, small horses, big birds, small birds, and so on. But never seen a fish turning into a horse. So the development within the species, it is a part of the creation for Allah. Creating the species, Allah has created. The flood times of Nuh, the earth, the word earth, Al-Ard in Arabic means land. It doesn't mean the planet Earth. So it doesn't mean you had one flood that flooded the whole Earth, the whole globe. It flooded the land where Nuh was living. The people, the kuffar of his time. Did it include China, Europe, America? So nothing mentioned in it. So now when you have creationists trying to find in the Death Valley science, though there was a flood there and so on, that doesn't concern us. There's nothing in our religion telling us, oh, the flood engulfed the whole planet Earth. Al-Ard in Arabic means land. It doesn't mean the whole globe of it. And so on. So the Israeliyah, what's mentioned, if it doesn't conflict with a religious fact or with a scientific fact, we can take it as a clue. We don't have to believe in it or contradict it. A bit longer answer, but it is something that happens commonly. So we're talking about the preconditions of salah, how one should be the state of wudu, his clothes should be clean, the place that he's praying should be clean, he should be heading towards qibla. You should have the intention, and then when he says Allahu Akbar, do it standing up if he can. You see, we talked about dua al-istiftah, what you say, subhanakallah bihamdika wa tabaraka ismuka wa ta'ala jadduka wa la ilaha ghayruk. And then there's at least another 5 or 6 variations, all of them reported from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَجَّهْتُ وَجْهِيَ الَّذِي فَطَرَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ حَنِيفًا مُسْلِمًا وَمَا أَنَا مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ. And so on. So there's a lot of dua. And it is recommended that you learn more than one. So that way helps you get focused. Sometimes people, from habit, they don't know what they're saying. Like, Allahu Akbar, next thing they know, they're doing ruku'ah. They don't know what kind of du'a they said, whether they read Fatiha or not. So having variations give you the concentration. What du'a I'm going to be choosing? So it helps you here. And then we talked about reading Al-Fatiha, that it is a rukun, a pillar of the salah. Whoever has the chance to read Al-Fatiha and doesn't read it, that ruk'ah is not counted. I'm saying having the chance, because sometimes you might be late to the salah and the imam is about done with the fatiha, you don't have room, he's already in ruku'ah. So your ruk'ah is valid because you're not intentionally skipped al-fatiha. And then we talk about isti'adha, a'udhu billahi minash shaytanir rajim, that it is a must. The consensus of ulama, at least once, the first time you read the Fatiha, that you say A'udhu billahi minash shaytanir rajim. Saying it after each ruk'ah, there's a disagreement. If you have a chance to do it, then that's something good. But if your imam is very quick in reading Al-Fatiha, you barely can say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim and Al-Fatiha, then you go, because Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim is part of Al-Fatiha. Ameen is not part of Al-Fatiha. So, if you can say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim until Walad Dhalin, you fulfill the requirement, minimum requirement of reading Al-Fatiha. If you can, A'udhu Billahi Minash Shaitan Rajeem, and Ameen at the end, that will make it more perfect.
Yeah. And the Rukun of Qira'at Al-Fatiha, what do the ulama say about the hadith that says that Qira'at Al-Fatiha of the Imam
Qira'at Al-Ma'mum?
So does that apply for the salahs out loud, or the madahib that say you have to be Fatiha says no, even in the salahs that are out loud, you have to say it in front of the Imam?
So the Jumhur al-Ulama say, if you hear the Imam, it's enough for you. If you don't hear Imam because it's a secret reading, or the Imam is far away from you where you cannot hear, then you have to read it. In the Hanafi Madhab, no. Even in secret reading, when it is reading, you don't have to read it because he's reading for you. But Wallahu Alam, the purpose of it, you need either hear the Imam saying it, so you say Ameen. فإن وافق تأمينه تأمين الإمام غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه أو غفر له ذنبه. So whoever finishes with the Imam and he says Ameen with the Imam, all his past sins are gone. So how are we going to say it if you don't hear him or you don't recite it yourself? So that's why everybody, when the Imam finishes and he says Ameen, you say Ameen. But you need to hear him saying Ameen. You don't do it before him. It's not like when the Imam finishes, Walad Dhalin, Ameen. The Imam hasn't said Ameen, yes. فَمَنْ وَافَقَ تَأْمِينُهُ تَأْمِينَ الْإِمَامِ. Your Ta'meen should be with the Imam. With it or shortly after it, included in the same time frame, but not before him. So give time for your Imam to take his breath and say Ameen.
Sheikh.
Now,
is there a difference between mazahib, the time for praying? So sometimes imam pray fast.
No.
And sometimes imam take time. For example, sometimes we pray asr in 5 minutes. And sometimes we pray asr in 15 minutes.
No.
With another imam. Can you explain that for us, please?
So it's not a difference between madahib. It's how fast the imam is reading. There's a minimum speed that one should not. Normally, slower is better. So you need, Rasulullah sallam kana qira'atu yuqatti'u al-fatiha. So when you say, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahmanir Rahim. So every ayah, he will stop at the end of it. He would not recite al-fatiha one breath. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahmanir Rahim, Malikim. He wouldn't say that. And he doesn't want people to give it as if they're just spraying it. So you need to say it slow enough to comprehend what you're saying. Most imam don't do that. And this is wrong. It has nothing to do with madhab. This is about a habit that they don't get wrong, whether you're reading for yourself or somebody else. At the same time, you don't make it too long. You don't say every time, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. Then you take a breath for a couple minutes, and then No. So it should be moderation is the best time. But some people are faster than others. Even the narration when Umar radiallahu anhu, when he ordered an imam to lead the people in Taraweeh. So he said, for the one who read fast, they should read 20 ayah. And for the ones who reading slow, they read 15 ayah. So he recognized some people read faster than others. But it should be within reason that's enough for a person to, if you're hearing him to listen, if it is a secret salah, that's enough for you to read. But some people, a lot of people, in the third and fourth ruqah, you're not able to say, A'udhu billahi min shaitan rajim, read the whole Fatiha and say al-Ameen. So you have to pick and choose, you barely, and sometimes you have to read it all in one breath, otherwise you're not going to be able to do it, and this is wrong. It's a responsibility for the imam to take care of these people behind him. Now what happens if you are faster than the imam? The imam is taking his time, you're used to imams that are fast. You're done with Ameen. And still the imam hasn't make his ruku'ah. You made dua. You ask Allah for forgiveness, and for Jannah, for, save you from hellfire. You can read an ayah. So even in the third and fourth ruku'ah, there are narration, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, sometimes he read another surah after al-Fatiha. So you have options. You don't have just sit and there, okay, why he's not making ruku'ah. It's a chance for you. Either make dua or read.
What about the minimum time for ruku'ah and sujood?
The same thing. Your bones need to settle. It's not an exercise. It's not Allahu Akbar, Sami Allahu Rabbana. This is wrong. Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, for that person who made his prayer wrong, he said, go back and pray. You have not prayed. So it should be enough where you settle. At least one time say a decent Subhana Rabbi Al-Azim. This is the minimum. Saying the sunnah three times is better. Little bit longer, you can do it longer occasionally if you know people behind you are strong enough or they're not very busy. If you're middle of the day, you know we have students or workers, they barely have 10 minutes to pray with you. You don't make your prayer half an hour. You're not going to read Surah Al-Baqarah when people are that busy behind you. So you need to take an account of people behind you, make it reasonable. So most of the time, you're going to be reading about a half a page, maximum one page. When Rasulullah sallam, he told Mu'adh, he told him, اقرأ وَالشَّمْسُ وَضُحَاهَا and so on. So things about half a page to one page long when you're reading. So moderation is best. A little bit, the most of the recitation side should be slower than most imams are doing. The sunnah is to give yourself time. This is in front of Allah. It's not an exercise what you can spell. It's about concentration and intending what you're saying. So if you don't have time to say Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, and you're comprehending that this is in the name of Allah, the merciful, the one that grants mercy. So you're in front of him and you're asking for his mercy, and every word you're understanding what it is, then that gives you the khushu'. Otherwise you'll be done with the salah as if you haven't prayed. Yeah, so more time gives more khushu'.
You've mentioned that the duty of the imam is to take care and to be responsible over the ma'mum. So let's say, you know, you do your due diligence, you make your isti'adha, you say the ameen, you take your time, but you just happen to notice that somebody behind you is just, they're still on ar-Rahman ar-Rahim for whatever reason, maybe they have waswas or whatever. Is it sensible to just sit and wait for him, for them to maybe catch up?
No, beyond the reasonable, you don't have to. Yeah, some people are reading very slow, some people keep repeating, A'udhu billahi shaitan rajim, and they keep doing it. You don't have. You have to be responsible for the moderation. Yeah, the extremes, you don't have to do that.
Regarding saying Subhana Rabbiyal Azim once, if I join the prayer late, and so I make the first takbir, takbirat al-ihram, and then I make the second takbir of ruku', and then while I'm saying Subhana Rabbiyal A'la, the imam was saying Sami Allahu Liman Hamidah, would that rak'ah count? Or do I need to finish my Subhana Rabbiyal Azim first, and then if he said Subhanallah Liman Hamidah, then it would count?
What counts is the jama'ah that you're with. Man adraka ruk'ah ma'al imam. So as long as your ruk'ah with the imam, that means with everybody that are with the imam, as long as you with them, you finish the ruk'ah, you read that counted. So you ruku'. So as long as he might be finishing and he doesn't say Allahu Akbar. He's سمع الله لمن حمده. You say Allahu Akbar. You're going to ruku' while he's going up, and then when he stood up, he say سمع الله لمن حمده. You already finish your ruku', you settle with everybody else, say Subhan Rabbi al-Azim, سمع الله. That counts. If you're not sure, be slow and repeat that ruk'ah is better than rush it and not feel the khushu'. Because at the end, Allah wants from you taqwa. وَلَكِنْ يَنَالُهُ التَّقْوَى مِنْكُمْ. So this is what Allah doesn't want the actions itself as much as the piety, the devotion that you show to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Sheikh, the imam, he must know the shurut as-salat, 9 first, and then the 14 qirans,
mm-hmm.
and then the sunan.
Yeah.
Because I see a lot of people, they like to go imam.
Mm-hmm.
So if he don't know this one, for example, the 14 pillars, mm-hmm. if we miss one, the rak'ah is not counted. Yes?
Yeah.
So if the imam, he don't know, he will make a mistake, I know. If he know, he will fix it.
Yeah.
So he must know this one?
Yeah, so most people who pray, they know
if
it.
You don't know also what happened.
Yeah, so most people who pray, they know it, but they don't know that this is rukun, this is shart, this is wajib. So you don't necessarily need to know the details. It's like the Arabs, they knew the grammars of Arabic language without knowing, oh, this is mubtada, this is khabar, this is fa'al, this is maf'ul. They know it. This is something they know. And a lot of people who pray, they know how to do it. Allahu Akbar, they say dua istiftah, they say al-fatiha, they make ruku', make sujood. But you ask them, what count to me, what are rukun, what is shart, what is wajib? They don't know. But they're doing it correctly. So as long as at the end they're doing it correctly, it's okay. The same thing somebody learned al-Fatiha to pronounce it correctly without knowing ahkam al-tajweed. He doesn't know that this is ghunna, this is mad, and this is ikhfa and adhar, but he's saying correctly, that's the end what it counts. So these divisions are from ulama to help people when they make a mistake to understand which mistake invalidates the salah or that ruk'ah, which mistakes you can compensate for it by doing sujood al-sahw. So if somebody missed the Fatiha, he has to repeat Raka. But if he missed reciting the surah after it, he can make sujood as-sahw. So this is between rukun and wajib. So that helps later on.
Yeah, but I see the imam, this is, if
mm-hmm.
you don't know,
yeah.
he cannot fix it.
Yeah.
Because if you know something,
yeah.
he will fix it.
Yes, that's so why.
This person, the 14 pillars
mm.
for the salah, the imam, he don't know. If he don't know how, he will fix it.
Yeah.
Because he will miss something. For example, we say, Sami Allahu liman hamid, one of the pillars of the 14. He missed this one. Or the qunut. Or the last head.
You talk about the wajibat, yeah.
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 If he missed for this one,
yeah.
this imam, he don't know.
Yeah.
And
well, that's why you need to learn. So,
yes.
Now.
So is the ilm for this one,
yeah.
before his imam,
yeah.
Is a must to him this one before he be imam, or
when there's a choice, when there is a choice.
Yeah.
So somebody is gonna be chosen as an imam. He shouldn't be chosen. He knows he's gonna be building a new masjid. Gonna choose an imam. If he doesn't know that, he shouldn't be an imam. But we're talking about sometimes it happens. People are gonna pray, and one of the person leading the imam, you have assigned. Yeah, that's why it should be أقرأهم للقرآن. يا أم الناس أقرأهم القرآن. The one who reads Quran best, not only with pronunciation, with comprehension, understanding. So that's what you need to do. If you're not sure, let somebody else lead. You still get the reward. هل يجهر بالبسملة؟ عن أنس رضي الله عنه أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وأبا بكر وعمر رضي الله عنهما كانوا يفتتحون الصلاة بالحمد لله رب العالمين. وقد بوب له البخاري بقوله باب ما يقول بعد التكبير، وهو مما يدل على عدم التلفظ بالبسملة. أن البخاري قال ما يقول بعد التكبير، قال كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وأبا بكر وعمر يفتتحون الصلاة بالحمد لله رب العالمين. يعني يقرأها ولا يجهر بها. يبدأ الجهر بالحمد لله رب العالمين. So here we're talking the point. When he's saying, we said that بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم is part of Fatiha. Well, if it's part of Fatiha, that means you should read it aloud, right? But the Rasulullah did not read it aloud. Imam al-Bukhari, in his book of Salah, when he was talking, he said, what should the Imam say after Allahu Akbar? He said, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Abu Bakr and Umar, after they say aloud Allahu Akbar, the first thing people will hear aloud is Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. That means they say dua al-istiftah, they say A'udhu Billahi Minash Shaitan Rajeem, they say Bismillahir Rahman Rahim, all in secret. And the first thing aloud people will hear, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. Yeah. So this is the fuqh of Imam Bukhari. He's mentioning the hadith, he gives the title, he means the hadith, that means his ijtihad is, you only say Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen aloud. وقد بوب النووي له بقوله باب حجتي من قال لا يجهر بالبسملة. And Imam al-Nawawi also, he mentioned that this is a proof for those who say that you should not say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim Allah. Now, Imam al-Nawawi is Shafi'i. Madhab al-Shafi'i, he say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim Allah. So Imam al-Nawawi, he's a alim of hadith. Yes, he follows Imam al-Shafi'i. But when you have a hadith that contradicts your imam, as we mentioned last time, you go with the hadith. And that's what he said. There's a proof here. The opinion of people who say you have to read it is just saying that Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim is part of the salah. وقال شيخ الإسلام رحمه الله إذا ذكر شيخ الإسلام ولم يحدث وهو ابن تيمية. هناك كثير من المشايخ سموا شيخ الإسلام لكن أشهرهم كان ابن تيمية. قال شيخ الإسلام رحمه الله في الفتاوى وأما البسملة فلا ريب أنه كان في الصحابة من يجهر بها وفيهم من كان لا يجهر بها بل يقرأها سرا أو لا يقرأها والذين كانوا يجهرون بها أكثرهم كان يجهر بها تارة ويخافت بها تارة هذا لأن الذكر قد تكون السنة المخافتة به ويجهر به لمصلحة راجحة مثل تعليم المأمومين فإنه قد ثبت في الصحيح أن ابن عباس قد جهر بالفاتحة على الجنازة ليعلمهم أنها سنة. So شيخ الإسلام he kind of summarized it. He said some of the صحابة read بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم aloud but not always and said there is a reason for that, the teaching people not to skip بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم but they know the sunnah is not to read it aloud. So if there is a reason to read it aloud, they'll do it as a teaching, but most of the time they would not. Most of the Sahaba would not. And then mentioning like Ibn Abbas in Salat al-Janazah, when reciting Al-Fatiha, he would recite it aloud. So people know. You know, Salat al-Janazah is different from any Salah. Because it is four times you say Allahu Akbar. There's no ruku', no sujood in it. And it's all in secret. So some people don't know what to do. They might attend the janazah once every 5 years, 10 years, and they say Allahu Akbar, then Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. So he read it aloud to know that they read he reads Surah Al-Fatiha.
Janazah salat, just the basmala out loud, everything else quietly, or the entire qira'ah, every part out loud?
Because the only part that it is always you read it is Surah Al-Fatiha. There's no surah after Al-Fatiha. You only read Surah Al-Fatiha. Then you make a salah on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then you can dua for the dead person. So people need to know that Fatiha is part of it. Then the dua, everybody, they know they're in a janazah. They're asking Allah to forgive the one who's dead. So the rest of it makes sense. But then Fatiha, a lot of them wouldn't know where they're going to be reading it. So the summarization is, you follow the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you don't read Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim aloud. Sometimes you might do it to teach people who are new to Islam or kids and so on, that you need to say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim with part of Fatiha, but you don't do it every time. هل البسملة آية من الفاتحة؟ قد اختلف في ذلك، والراجح أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قد عدها آية، كما في حديث أم سلمة ذكرت قراءة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم: بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك الدين، يقطع قراءته آية آية. حديث صحيح أخرجه أبو داود والبيهقي والترمذي. So رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم counted بسم الله as part of الفاتحة. أم سلمة his wife أم المؤمنين said when رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم he used to recite he would say بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين. He would stop at the end of each ayah and this is was his recitation. So that means he counted بسم الله as part of سورة الفاتحة. من لا يستطيع حفظ الفاتحة، من لم يستطع أن يأخذ شيئا من القرآن فليقول سبحان الله والحمد لله ولا إله إلا الله والله أكبر ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. So if you don't know how to say الفاتحة, you make تسبيح. Say سبحان الله الحمد لله لا إله إلا الله الله أكبر لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. Now for somebody who doesn't know Arabic, if he knows that, he can memorize الفاتحة. But for people who know Arabic but they're not good in memorizing the fact, because these words make sense to most Arab speaking people, but some of them they don't have the knowledge to go further to memorize the whole Al-Fatiha. So this is applied to a very small percentage of the population. Then they say that dua. لحديث عبد الله بن أوفى قال جاء رجل إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال إني لا أستطيع أن آخذ شيئا من القرآن فعلمني ما يجزئني. So a man came to Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. He said, I cannot memorize anything of this Quran. That's the way his brain is. He cannot. Probably nowadays they call him learning disability. So he cannot learn. Say, just teach me something I can say. Say, okay, you can say this word, right? Subhanallah, yeah, I can say subhanallah. They say, but alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar, la ilaha illallah, la hawla wa la quwwata. Yeah, I can say that. Then say it. This is what you need to say. ولحديث رفاعة بن رافع أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم علم رجلا الصلاة فقال إن كان معك قرآن فقرأ وإلا فاحمده وكبره وهلله ثم اركع. Another narration, Rasulullah sallam taught a man to pray. Say, if you memorize Quran, say it. If you don't, then say, Alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar, La ilaha illallah, and then make your ruku. Because remember, as we said, what Allah wants is wants devotion from you, sincerity. You remember Him. So if you can do it perfectly the way He taught us, Al-Fatiha is the biggest thing ever revealed. The biggest surah in the whole Quran, bigger than what's ever revealed in Old Testament, New Testament, Torah, Injil, and so on. It's the best surah ever. But some people cannot learn it. Then at least they can say the dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when they're glorifying Allah, when they're praising Allah, and acknowledging the oneness of Allah. ولكن لابد أن يبذل الجهد في تعلم الفاتحة فإن عجز فلا يكلفه الله إلا وسعه. But he still have to try. So not just because once is early into Islam and first we couldn't remember, so okay, I have an easy way out, I will never learn it. No, you still have to try and learn it. هل تقرأ الفاتحة خلف الإمام؟ الأصل أن الصلاة لا تصح إلا بقراءة سورة الفاتحة في كل ركعة من ركعات الفرض والنفل، إلا أن المأموم تسقط عنه القراءة ويجب عليه الاستماع والإنصات في الصلاة الجهرية لقوله تعالى وإذا قرئ القرآن فاستمعوا له وأنصتوا لعلكم ترحمون، ولقول رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا كبر الإمام فكبروا وإذا قرأ فأنصتوا. وهذا يحمل أي حديث من كان له إمام فقراءة الإمام له قراءة. So, do you read it since الفاتحة is a ركن of صلاة? Do you read it even if you have an Imam? If the Imam is reading and you say it's aloud, you hear them, his recitation is good enough for you. Because the order is in Quran, when Quran is recited, you listen, you keep quiet and listen to it. If you're going to be reading the Fatiha, you're not listening to the Imam. You have your own recitation. So you listen to the Imam. وَأَمَّا الصَّلَاةُ السِّرِّيَّةُ فَالْقِرَاءَةُ فِيهَا عَلَى الْمَأْمُومِ وكذلك تجب عليه القراءة في الصلاة الجهرية إذا تمكن من الاستماع للإمام. So when it is a loud prayer, you listen to the Imam, it's enough for you. If it's a secret prayer, you need to recite it. Now, can you recite with the Imam? You can, but not allowed. There's a narration of it. وقد أجاز كان في صلاة الفجر فقرأ فثقلت عليه القراءة فلما فرغ قال لعلكم تقرؤون خلف إمامكم قلنا نعم هذا يا رسول الله قال لا تفعلوا إلا أن يقرأ أحدكم بفاتحة الكتاب فإنه لا صلاة لمن لم يقرأ بها. So there was one narration, Rasulullah Sallam praying Fajr. This is a loud prayer. And he couldn't keep concentration. There was some disturbance behind this. When he finished, he said, are you reciting with your Imam, that is with me? He said, yes. He said, don't do that. Keep distracted. Unless you are reading Al-Fatiha, but they shouldn't recite it aloud to distract others. So when the Imam is reading, you can read with him secretly or listen to him. The majority of us, if you can focus with the Imam, that will be better. If you're far away from him or you cannot hear it correctly, you're hearing some words, sometimes you're not, then you can read with him without saying aloud, disturbing the Imam or people around you. وفي رواية من كان له إمام فقراءة الإمام له قراءة يعني في الجهرية. التأمين جهرا فقد كان صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا انتهى من قراءة الفاتحة قال آمين يجهر ويمد بها صوته. And then once you finish, Rasulullah Sallam used when he finished Al-Fatiha, he say Ameen, he say it aloud, and he say it long. Ameen. So it's not Ameen. Ameen. So he make it long and aloud. وعن أبي رافع قال إن أبا هريرة كان يؤذن لمروان بن الحكم فاشترط أن لا يسبقه بالضالين حتى يعلم أنه قد دخل الصف فكان إذا قال مروان ولا الضالين قال أبو هريرة آمين يمد بها صوته وقال إذا وافق تأمين أهل الأرض تأمين أهل السماء غفر لهم وقال عطاء أمن ابن الزبير ومن وراءه حتى إن للمسجد للجة. So there's narrations from the Sahaba that they used to wait when they say ولا الضالين, they say آمين aloud extending their voice with it. Narration from Abu Huraira, narration from Ibn Zubayr, and that people behind him will say Ameen until we feel the whole masjid is tremoring from the sound.
So when a person is joining late,
yeah,
and Imam has finished reciting Surah Fatiha,
yeah,
and reciting some other surah, so do we have to just listen or we can recite Surah Fatiha?
You listen.
We don't have to recite.
Yeah, you don't recite Surah Al-Fatiha. Because here you're going to be skipping what the Imam is doing. The Imam already, he recited for you. Once you joined him, whatever he's done is counted for you. So this is the benefit of having an Imam.
موافقة الإمام في التأمين كان صلى الله عليه وسلم يأمر المقتدين بالتأمين بعيد تأمين الإمام فيقول إذا قال الإمام غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين فقولوا آمين فإن الملائكة تقول آمين وإن الإمام يقول آمين فمن وافق تأمينه تأمين الملائكة وفي رواية والملائكة في السماء غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه.
And then Rasulullah sallam, he ordered people behind him, say when the imam says walad dalin and he sits ameen, the angels will say ameen. If your ameen coincide with the imam and with the angels, all your past sins are gone. So saying ameen aloud is part of the sunnah. If it's not allowed, at least in secret, but you need to say ameen. And you need to make sure that the imam is saying it. As we said, you don't jump ahead of the imam and saying ameen. Ma'na ameen. Ameen, du'a'un ma'naah, Allahumma stajib. Wa huwa min asma'i al-af'al min masdari ammana. Ay qala ameen. Wa hiya bil maddi wa takhfif. Ameen, ameen. عند جميع القراء بالمد والتخفيف آمين لا يقول آمين المد آ والتخفيف مين. So the word آمين in Arabic means asking Allah to respond, and it is آمين not آمين. You don't make shadda on the mean. آمين means from أما that I'm leading the prayer. So different meaning. Ameen, asking Allah to respond. Ameen, saying, I'm leading the prayer. Which has no point here. So, Ameen. وفي الصلاة السرية يجب على المأمومين أن يقرأوا بفاتحة الكتاب وسورة في الركعتين الأوليين وفي الأخريين بفاتحة الكتاب. وإنما أنكر التشويش عليه بها. So Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, he taught the Sahaba that if the Salah is secret, they need to recite al-Fatiha, they recite the Surah, the first two ruk'ah. If it is four Dhuhr Asr, then they recite just Al-Fatiha. If it's Maghrib, just Al-Fatiha, the third Ruk'ah. But he said, you don't read it aloud to disturb and distract people around you and the Imam. فَصَلَّ الظُّهْرَ بِأَصْحَابِ فَقَالَ أَيُّكُمْ قَرَأَ سَبِّحْ اسْمَ رَبِّكَ الْأَعْلَى قَالَ رَجُلٌ أَنَا وَلَمْ أُرِدْ بِهَا إِلَّا الْخَيْرِ قَالَ قَدْ عَرِفْتُ أَنَّ رَجُلًا خَالَجْنِيهَا وفي رواية خلطتم علي القرآن وقال إن المصلي يناجي ربه فلينظر بما يناجيه به ولا يجهر بعضكم على بعض بالقرآن. So Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم once was reading in a secret prayer. After he finished, he said, who was reading سبحان ربي الأعلى سبح اسم ربك الأعلى. Man said, I, and I was intending good. He said, you are distracting me. It's like you're fighting me with it. I mean, he's not keeping the pace. He shouldn't be reading it aloud. He said, you should not mix Quran with one another. Recite. You need to focus so you get the reward from Allah, but don't make it aloud, distract one another. قراءته صلى الله عليه وسلم بعد الفاتحة كان يقرأ بعد الفاتحة سورة غيرها وكان يطيلها أحيانا ويقصرها أحيانا لعارض سفر أو سعال أو مرض أو بكاء صبي كما قال أنس بن مالك رضي الله عنه جوز صلى الله عليه وسلم ذات يوم في الفجر وفي حديث آخر صلى الصبح فقرأ بأقصر سورتين في القرآن فقيل يا رسول الله لما جوزت قال سمعت بكاء صبي فظننت أن أمه معنا تصلي فأردت أن أفرغ له أمه. Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, after Fatiha, he will recite a surah. He might make it long, he might make it short, especially if there is a reason. If he's sick, sometimes he's coughing, he cut it short. And there was one time he read in Fajr, the shortest two surah in Quran, when he read it. When he's finished, people ask him, why you made it that short? Usually in Fajr, the recitation is long. He said, I heard a baby crying. And I thought his mother with him and she wants to finish quickly so she can attend to him. So he made his recitation short so she can attend to the baby.
Sure.
Look, now.
Speaking of babies, if there is a baby in front of the imam and he's about to do something reckless, like should the imam interfere or should he wait for somebody from the first line to interfere and like, go take care of whatever is happening?
It depends. So if something dangerous, they should interfere. Anybody should interfere. So when there is danger, regardless who's praying, you should interfere, stop that danger. Whether it's fire, a baby gonna do something wrong, there's a snake, a scorpion, whatever it is, you take care of it, even if you're praying. But if you're just disturbing, he's playing around, nothing is happening, let it be.
It's just that sometimes, you know, you might have a kid who's like playing next to the electricity, like the electric outlet.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. If there's danger, yes, there's electricity, and he's gonna harm himself, yes, you need to interfere, or somebody, but somebody need to take an action, either the imam or the ma'mum. Because the electricity might be closer to somebody next to him, they can do it, or the imam himself, depending where it is. Yeah, harm, it need to be stopped.
Exactly. A lot of the matters you're mentioning are matters of difference of opinion, mm-hmm. and like significantly, because the four are ulama, they all differ on these issues, saying the ta'min allowed, mm-hmm. the fatiha, the basmala. Mm-hmm. So, despite the fact that we have these explicit hadith, mm-hmm. how do they have these rulings?
I wouldn't say the majority of them disagree on it. There's a small minority disagree, and they have a reason for the disagreement. As we said, like Imam Shafi'i, just because Bismillah is part of Al-Fatiha, his opinion, well, it has to be recited. And we know some of the Sahaba recited it, but not always. So now we know if you want to follow the proper Sunnah. That's why I like these books that don't stick to one madhab, so you don't have to teach you one ijtihad. They mentioned other ijtihad, but say the most straightforward ijtihad that goes with the hadith is what? It might sometimes coincide with three of the madhab, might be one of the madhab, four of the madhab, but at the end you're learning what, if you are living in town of the Sahaba, you're trying to learn Islam. You might hear a little bit different people, it's going to be that small difference, not a big difference. And when there is a difference, you would understand. It's not intentional difference. It's about the understanding of the text. And we hear it from all the ulama and from their students that whenever you have a text that's proven, this is what you should follow. The opinion of the alim was to his best of ability to follow the text. The imma of madahib, they're not musharri'een, they do not legislate. They cannot make something halal or haram or farb or wajib. They try to explain it. So they just bringing knowledge, they don't create knowledge. So that's the difference. So, and they're ma'jur, because they are worthy of ijtihad, ahlul ijtihad. It's different from somebody making an opinion when he's not ahlul ijtihad. He haven't studied, haven't reached a level of making ijtihad. So even here, when we're reading, we cannot make ijtihad. We're reading the ijtihad of the ulama and learning from them rather than making our own ijtihad.
If somebody like interrupts
this,
stop a child from danger, how do they continue their salah?
They continue wherever they are. So if they're in ruku' and they're sujood, just to continue. The salah is valid.
And everything from before.
Yeah, still counted. Everything is counted. Yeah. I mean, we're talking about reasonable disturbance. Not like he left the masjid running after the child and come back. So that's what the whole thing is done. But I'm talking about reasonable, just catching him from falling or doing it. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, sometimes he would be praying and Al-Hasan Al-Husayn would be on his back. And he would make his sujood long until they're done and stand up. And sometimes he will go on the minbar. He make his recitation and ruku' and minbar when sujood, he steps down. So to teach people, there might be newcomers to Islam, they don't know how to stand, how to put their hands, how to make ruku'. But with sujood, they cannot do it on the member, on the steps, he will step down. So when there's a reason, movements are acceptable. But it should be minimum and because of a reason, not somebody sitting there. Sometimes you see young ones, 5, 6, sometimes even 10 years old, teenagers, they'll be turning one another, poking one another, laughing and giggling and so on. This is not proper. They will not get the count for the salah. وكان يقول أعطوا كل سورة حظها من الركوع والسجود. So it is better for every ruk'ah to have one proper surah read in it. This is the best way. Doesn't mean you can't read less. فقرأوا ما تيسر منه. Because in Quran it says, you read whatever is easy for you. So even one ruk'ah, one ayah, this ayah has to be a full sentence. Not just because it's an ayah, mudhammatan. And then the Quran, you say this is an ayah. It has to be a full sentence. That either jumla ismiya or jumla fa'liya. So that it should convey a meaning. سبح اسم ربك الأعلى. This is an order to glorify the name of Allah, the highest. This is a full sentence. So we can say سبح اسم ربك الأعلى and make ركوع. This is acceptable. So, but it is better to finish the whole surah in the rak'ah. You choose the surah according to the situation. If you're alone, you can choose as long as you want. You can pray in Surah Al-Baqarah. It's up to you. If you're leading people, you need to take an account as said recommendation is to read something reasonable, half a page, one a page. If you know people behind you, they comprehend Quran, a lot of them memorize Quran, you make it, want to make it longer and so on, you can make it, but take an account who is behind you. Are the people who comprehend it, they're young, they can stay with you, they're not busy and so on, and then you can do it. ويسن الزيادة عليها في الركعتين الأخريين أيضا أحيانا أي على صلاة الفاتحة. Sometimes in the last two ruk'ah, in whether ظهر عصر or عشاء, usually you just read الفاتحة. But sometimes he recited an ayah after الفاتحة. So if you alone you can do it. If your imam is very slow and you fast, you finished your فاتحة already third or fourth ruk'ah. You can start another surah, short surah, medium surah. You can do that.
So, when it is a silent prayer, imam is slow and you are faster than imam. If you are reading Fatiha before the imam, is it not like competing with the imam?
But only if you make it aloud. But you don't know what your imam is doing, because you don't have a timer. You don't know if your imam. If you know imam from the first. You don't know imam. In the third ruk'ah, he was very slow. Next time when you're reading your fatiha, make it a little bit slower. Slower your pace. He's giving you time to understand. Yeah. So you don't intentionally try to compete with the imam. But if it happens, this first time you pray behind this imam, and he's slower than your normal recitation, you have time. You can read another surah, or you can make dua. So you have an option, either one.
So it's forgiven, even if you...
Yes, yeah, because you're not doing intention. It's different from allowed, where you have to follow the imam with everything you do. You don't go ahead of him. ما كان يقرأ صلى الله عليه وسلم في الصلوات في الفجر كان يقرأ بطوال المفصل من سورة قاف وما بعدها السبع الأخير من القرآن. وكان يقرأ أحيانا بالواقعة ونحوها من السور في الركعتين. وقرأ في سورة الطور وذلك في حجة الوداع. وكان يقرأ بقاف القرآن المجيد ونحوها بالركعة الأولى. وكان يقرأ أحيانا بقصار مفصل كإذا الشمس كورت. وقرأ مرة إذا زلزلت في الركعتين كلتيهما حتى قال الراوي فلا أدري أنسي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أم قرأ ذلك عمدا. So in صلاة الفجر, sometimes he read it long. He would read from المفصل, مفصل from قاف till the end. So you might read from Surah Qaf, Surah Al-Dariyat, Surah Al-Tur, and so on. And sometimes you read the shorter ones. He would read the Shamsu Kuwas. And one time he read Idha Zulzilat, both Ruk'ah. So repeating the same surah in first and second Ruk'ah is permissible. Although that wasn't his habit. He done it once. The narrator say, I don't know if he done it because he forgot or intentional to teach us is okay to repeat it. So probably it is for more teaching. It is okay to do it. وفي السفر صلى ذات مرة قل أعوذ برب الفلق قل أعوذ برب الناس. One time he was traveling and he made it short. Just قل أعوذ برب الفلق قل أعوذ برب الناس. So that means you have a way of doing it, but he didn't recite the longest of the surah. So when you're talking about Surah Qaf, that's about 2.5 pages and so on. So you're talking about one page, 2 pages, 2.5 pages, depending who is behind you. At that time, remember when they're making Adhan al-Fajr, and then they're making Iqama afterwards, people need to wake up, use the bathroom, make wudu, and come to the masjid. A little bit time. That's why there was first adhan, second adhan, and iqamah. So some people will take a little bit longer to reach. So his recitation in Fajr was longer than other prayers. So the one praying should make his best to be praying to a barrier. So a wall or something similar to it. The shortest of it would be Akhirat al-Rahil, is like half a meter, like a foot and a half or a couple feet long. Something like this, you pray behind it. Enough for you to make sujood between it and that barrier. And nobody should cross in front of you. So this way you're not making sujood to that person that's coming to you. You stop them if you can. Now, if they are beyond your arm reach, that means they are beyond your sujood reach. So you don't have to chase people there, like 4 feet, 5 feet away from you. You don't have to chase them. And people should be aware of that. We teach it to our children. They shouldn't cross in front of somebody. But they don't have to go to the furthest part of the masjid, 40 feet, 50 feet away, so they're not crossing in front of him. Second of all, it's a responsibility when praying to make his best. So you cannot pray at the entrance and blocking the door and everybody else where the whole masjid is empty. So that's also a responsibility. You see some people praying at the very back when they can pray in the very front or behind one of the pillars. So there is responsibilities here.
Yeah.
You put your, somebody trying to cross with you, you put your arm in front of him. Most people, once they see it, they might not realize that you're praying. They might be, they notice, they go around. Yeah. There's one hadith tell you if you have to fight him, he has a shaitan with it. Yes, but most of the time it doesn't reach that point. Yeah. There's a misconception that in Masjid al-Haram, and some people even say Masjid Nawawi, it's okay to cross in front of him. It's not. But it happens sometimes because there's no other way. It's so crowded that somebody praying and people have to cross, it happens. But if you have an option not to cross in front of somebody praying, you should take that up. Go behind them, around them, whatever it is. But remember, in Mecca, you'll be praying and somebody cross in front, and there's a lot of space. And they try some, oh, this is Masjid Haram, no problem. No, it is a problem. So tell me what I happen to do. Every time I'm praying, I go close to the column so nobody can cross in front of me. Then I step a little bit so my ruku, my head almost touching the column, making my sujood when my head touching so nobody cross in front of me. So instead of making concentration, your khushu' of salah, you come concentrating not to allow anybody crossing in front of you. So it beats the whole purpose of khushu'. You do your best, but at some time you give up. Discuss it, just focus on your recitation and just keep going.
Yeah, we have some hadiths that the shaitan is not
person. Yeah. I mean, you do your best.
Yeah.
The whole thing is about between you and Allah. Yeah. So you do your best to get closer to Allah.
One of our convert brothers, they asked about at what point does the person walking in front of you, or let me clarify, does anything walking in front of you break your salah? And specifically, they mentioned the black dog, the donkey, and a woman passing in front of a man, or a woman passing in front of another woman.
I don't know about a woman passing in front of another woman. It's definitely if it's in front of another man, it would break his head. If she between him and his place of sujood. But if it is farther away, then it doesn't. And the same thing applies for a dog or a donkey. Alhamdulillah, nowadays I don't think ever happened to me that a dog or a donkey passed in front of me. But as I said, in crowded places of Masjid Haram, you might have men or women coming in front of you. If it happens to you, a woman, you can stop her. You have to repeat your salah.
And you said this is a misconception that people are allowed to walk.
That's a misconception.
We have another question. One of our brothers, so he has long hair and he plans to cut it short. So he was asking, are there any regulations from the Sunnah to cut his hair? Like, is there anything that is allowed or not allowed? Before he cuts his hair so that he adheres to the sun.
So the only thing that's not allowed is to resemble a sign of people of different faith. That's the only thing. So, you know, like Buddhists, they shave it from here, they keep some kind of hair sticking from there, or any of these odd shavings or cuts. That once you see it, you know, these people belong to that group. Second of all, not to resemble the sinners. So if some people like having, I don't know, mohawks and stuff like this, you're not going to find anybody of faith doing that. Beyond that, then with reason, what is common in your time, in your place, that's considered decent for men. The time the Sahaba was very common to have long hair, and they would use to braid it and so on. Nowadays, it's not common. If somebody have long hair, people look at him, what, is he sissy or something? He's trying to look like a woman. So you need to keep the tradition of the place. Nowadays, among young people, keeping big hairs. It's common, it's now accepted. My time, big hair, what, are you homeless? You're nobody taking care of you? That's why I see the older people, the boomers, when they see younger people, say, what's wrong with them? Why they look like hobos? Or stay? But this is what it is nowadays. So it has to be within reason, where you don't make yourself belong to a group of different faith or belong to a group of bad character. That's what Allah.
And one question about zakat. Brother asked the question that what if the time for zakat comes and you didn't know, you forgot that someone owes you money, like a large sum of money.
Yeah.
And you pay your zakat, and then after you paid it sometime, you get that large sum of money. Do you have to go back and pay again from the money that you have because it was owed to you?
Well, it depends always when it's a debt. Is it reasonably accepted a debt you can get it? You loan your money, somebody is rich. And you know, anytime you can ask him. You loan them $100,000, I ask him tomorrow. It's as if the money in your pocket, you're just waiting anytime. Then you need to pay zakat. It's as if you have it. No, it's money you don't know. You give it to him, he's investing it in something, he's waiting for his investment. You don't know. You don't start counting it until you collect. So I put my money with somebody who's investing in cars, and I don't know when he's going to get it back. So there's one thing I just want to mention before we make the end. One brother remind me, you've seen some brothers when they're praying, when they're making sujood, their nose is not touching. It's not enough for the forehead to touch the ground. The nose need to touch the ground also. So just be aware of it. A lot of times, because we're praying on carpets, we don't feel it, but you don't have to push it too hard to hurt your nose, but at least just to touch. So nose and the forehead should be part of the face. So we'll make adhan, inshallah. We'll pray subna. Subhanakallahumma. Alhamdulillah. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.